And the Oscar goes to Quentin Tarantino, Roger Avery for Pulp Fiction.
Quentin Tarantino sucks. So this here is the highest point of Quentin Tarantino's career. And at this highest point in Quentin Tarantino's career, but who's this guy with him? And what did Anthony Hopkins say? The Oscar goes to Quentin Tarantino and Roger Avery? Who is this Roger Avery? And what might he be doing with Quentin Tarantino at the highest point in Quentin Tarantino's career? Well, it turns out these two started out as geeks. At least, I guess they ended up as geeks. They started out as geeks in a video store. And they worked on screenplays together. I'll assume that Quentin Tarantino had the majority of the creativity, but it cannot be denied that Roger Avery had considerable involvement in the writing process of Quentin Tarantino's first few movies or screenplays. So it's impossible to get into why Quentin Tarantino sucks without acknowledging why Roger Avery also sucked, or why Roger Avery was with Quentin Tarantino up until the highlight of Quentin Tarantino's career. Now, every dork has his day. Reservoir Dorks is where we will start. I was born in 77, so I was 15 when it came out. I think I saw it on video, and me and my friends were very impressed, and we'd go on about how great it was. The main thing I remember being impressed by was the Mr. Blonde, Mr. Orange concept and all that, and the time shifts, and how it's a movie about a bank robbery, but we never see the bank robbery. Oh, also, me and my friends were really impressed with the whole cop fake story about the urinal, how you had to make up this story, and how you make up a story, and the art of lying, and all that. Today, at the old age of 47, I will say, in retrospect about the movie, it holds up as a really good movie. The time shifts are still amazing. The Mr. Blonde, Mr. Yellow, Mr. Orange, Mr. Green is still amazing. The lying, here's how to tell a lie about using a urinal to the cops, is still amazing. The bank robbery movie without a bank robbery scene is still amazing. The opening scene's really cool in that it's kind of novelistic, where it doesn't really matter when it I think it takes place before the robbery, but it doesn't really matter because it's just a scene that introduces everybody. And that scene is actually very similar to the scene, opening scene of Pulp Fiction, actually. A diner. Non-linear, right? Doesn't take place in a linear manner. I find the like a virgin small talk scene in the cafe to be very annoying. Very annoying in the same way the whole Big Mac and whatever the hell. Royale with cheese, all that small talk, I found that very annoying too. It also shows Quentin Tarantino's obsession with being cool, having to have everybody be cool. It also shows Quentin Tarantino's early ambitions to be an actor, because he still thought that he could, like, be in his own movies and people might think he was cool too. He still hoped that people wouldn't view him as a geeky-looking guy. And the whole ear-cutting-off scene showed his, again, his obsession with being cool and linking being cool to being violent or being a bully. Something which would feature in all of his movies going forward. Then, 1993, came Killing Zoe, which was written and directed by Roger Avery, starring Eric Stoltz, who would later show up in Pulp Fiction, as a character named Zed, who would also later show up in Pulp Fiction, and it's about robbing a bank. And I gotta wonder if this was the original idea for the bank robbery in Reservoir Dogs. I don't remember anything about this movie. I watched it once 20 years ago, 30 years ago. And the only thing I remember is the obsession with being cool was still strong. It's Quentin Tarantino and Roger Avery's obsession with being cool, except this is just Roger Avery's creation. So this movie, I guess, is worth watching if you want to sort of see one of the minds behind Reservoir Dogs, True Romance, Natural Born Killers, and Pulp Fiction. True Romance was a great movie. So why is this video titled Quentin Tarantino Sucks? Because this movie, as well as the previous one, Reservoir Dogs, and Natural Born Killers, Pulp Fiction, were so amazing. And he just dropped the ball after that. It was directed by Tony Scott, who was the brother of Ridley Scott. He died. And he also directed Beverly Hills Cop 2 and Top Gun. The scene with Drexel was amazing. The scene about Sicilians was amazing. The randomness that they find his wallet, that would be the way that they can track him, or that he left the address of where he was going on the fridge, I thought that was pretty clever. It's still obsessed with being cool, this movie, because being cool is really the underlying message of all of Quentin Tarantino's movies. There's no depth to his movies. There's no meaning. Which is, you know, that's fine. It prevents any of his stuff from being, like, true masterpieces. And he has that in common with Spielberg or Scorsese, who are, you know, really good directors. They just don't have any meaning behind anything they do. On that note, in 94, Natural Born Killers came out, directed by Oliver Stone, and he put meaning behind the movie. Which was funny, considering that Quentin Tarantino hated what Oliver Stone did with it. It kind of reminds me of how Stephen King hated Kubrick's version of The Shining, even though The Shining is probably the best, you know, it brought Stephen King's writer to a higher, deeper level. It was around this time that I realized who Quentin Tarantino was, in that he had done Reservoir Dogs and True Romance. It was then that I sort of, you know, realized he existed. And again, this movie was pretty amazing. But again, it's Quentin Tarantino's obsession with being cool, and being cool by hurting people, bullying people. Especially, that's how you're cool in Quentin Tarantino's world. I read an interview around this time with Quentin Tarantino, where Quentin Tarantino said that Oliver Stone told him, you know, Quentin, you make movies, I make films. And Quentin Tarantino was irked by that, annoyed by that, and he said, you know, that's fine, Pulp Fiction's coming out soon, and I'll put that against Natural Born Killers. And despite how good this movie was, it was hard to sympathize with the main characters, because they're just evil. So, you know, bullying people in order to prove that you're cool doesn't really fly with the popular audiences, unless they're, well, when they have no redeemable qualities. This was around the time that Kurt Cobain died, and I had the album In Utero, and there was a special thanks when it thanked all the people for the album, as they do on the sleeve of the CD. It thanked Quentin Tarantino, which I always thought was weird. And it was around this time that I moved to Vancouver from Toronto, and I saw Pulp Fiction in the theater in Vancouver. The most amazing thing about this movie, same as Reservoir Dogs for me, was the time shifts. Really genius ability to do time shifts, to tell a story in a non-linear fashion. Again, there's the obsession with being cool by bullying or hurting others. Oh, and again, like Reservoir Dogs, Quentin Tarantino puts himself in the movie because he's still hoping that he's going to be a big famous movie star. And again, the Royale with cheese talk and the pot belly talk was annoying as hell. Just like the like a virgin banter in the Reservoir Dogs movie. Very annoying. And a lot of the movie was really like nothing, you know? Like a big dance sequence and you know, them doing the laundry after they killed the guy. It's rumored that Roger Avery wrote the whole gimp sequence. But I think what really made this movie the best of anything he's ever done was the fact that it also had a moral, right? Like, you gotta get out while you have a chance, you should have taken the hint and got out, John Travolta, because, you know, you're gonna get killed. If Quentin Tarantino had died after this movie, he would have been known as a legend and people would have been theorizing what an amazing career he would have had. Then he did a segment in the movie Four Rooms in 95. A segment where basically he was just doing the same suspense kind of thing as the syringe scene in Pulp Fiction. And he also put himself as a main actor in his little movie, because he still thought that he might be a big shot, cool actor one day. You know, he was still hoping that he didn't look like the geek that he looks like. Then he also starred in a movie called Destiny Turns on the Radio, and he didn't direct or write it, but this is him being like, okay, I'm going to really go for it. I'm going to really try to be a cool actor. And I watched the movie, and I can't remember anything from it at all. John Belushi starred in it. I guess that's it. Jim Belushi, the one that didn't die, starred in it. From Dusk Till Dawn, when was this? 1996, a very disposable horror movie that everybody's made before. The dialogue was a little bit witty, because Quentin Tarantino wrote the screenplay. Quentin Tarantino, again, is trying to be a cool movie star. It's George Clooney's first major movie role after getting really famous on the show ER. Directed by Robert Rodriguez, who's pretty good at directing, but I don't know, it's a throwaway movie. However, this might have been Quentin Tarantino's first Revenge of the Nerds movie, that's what I call these movies, because it's okay to be brutal and violent if you're battling vampires, right? So since they're mutilating villains, evil people, it's okay, and audiences will come to see it, and they don't have to feel bad about themselves for watching it. So it's very much all about being cool by, you know, being really physically violent. Then in 1997, he does a directorial movie adaptation of Elmore Leonard's Jackie Brown. At this point, I think Quentin Tarantino realized that he was never going to be a cool movie star because he looks like a geek. God, you just know how badly he wants people to think he's cool. I'm not sure if it was before or after this movie came out that my mother told me, Quentin Tarantino said that Elmore Leonard is his favorite author. So I really looked up to Quentin Tarantino because of his first four movies, Reservoir Dogs, True Romance, Natural Born Killers, and Pulp Fiction. So I read Get Shorty by Elmore Leonard, and man, it's all about being cool. It's all about some cool hitman. And, you know, it just occurred to me that the sequel to Get Shorty was called Be Cool. So, I mean, how on the nose is that? But aside from that, this was Quentin Tarantino's first attempt, I think, at just directing a movie and honing his directorial skills with somebody else's material. And it was the only time he's ever done this, as far as I can tell. I don't remember anything about this movie except that I forgot everything about it. That's all I remember. There's nothing to remember in this very crappy movie. In 2002, Roger Avery directed a movie based on a Bret Easton Ellis novel called Rules of Attraction. Bret Easton Ellis had written American Psycho. Now, this movie is extremely cool. And by that, I mean it's not cool because it's trying to be cool. The only thing good about this movie, really, I mean, it's not a bad movie by any stretch, but it's not it's not worth watching either. The only cool thing about this movie is that there's an audio commentary for the DVD done by Carrot Top, the comedian, which is just a very random thing because Carrot Top had nothing to do with the movie. So Carrot Top just does a commentary and it's hilarious. Like, there's a scene where James Vanderbeek punches Jessica Biel in the face, and Carrot Top goes, "You can do that? I didn't know you could do that." But I'll tell you one thing, it was a hell of a lot better than Jackie Brown. Then in 2003, Quentin Tarantino does the Kill Bill movie. Now, I always call this the first of his revenge trilogy. My theory is that Quentin Tarantino really enjoys having people get the crap kicked out of them and get violently killed. And he thinks it makes people cool to do that. But he needs to have the main character be sympathetic. And so this movie is really women getting revenge on men. And yes, I know it's not just women getting revenge against men. It's actually a very good movie in a lot of ways, but it's a far cry from what I'd seen before in terms of Quentin Tarantino and his writing. It's not. It's one tenth of what Reservoir Dogs or Pulp Fiction were. When I first saw it, I think in the theaters, I was pleasantly surprised when they did like one time shift right at the beginning. But other than that, I'm like, dude, what you're really good at is the time shifts. I love, like, you're a genius when it comes to screwing with time and like flashing forward, flashing backward. And he didn't really do much of that in this. There was a cool Superman story anecdote at the end of the whole movie, which was pretty cool. But this was the beginning of how and when Quentino began to suck. And he would suck a lot more in the years to come. If Tarantino wasn't a permanent fixture in our psyches because of Pulp Fiction and Reservoir Dogs, I'm not so sure this movie would even have done well. So yeah, I call Kill Bill the first of Quentin Tarantino's Revenge of the Nerds trilogy. Then in 2006, we get Silent Hill, which was based on a video game, but the screenplay was written and I think directed by, it was directed, I don't know if he wrote this, I think he wrote the screenplay, done by Roger Avery. And I absolutely love this movie. I went to a, I saw a guy I know who writes for Fangoria magazine, and I told him my theory of Silent Hill, or what I think about it, which is that it's the best revenge movie ever made. Which is ironic, considering Quentin Tarantino is actually trying, like consciously trying to make revenge movies. This is like a real hardcore revenge movie. The best revenge movie, maybe ever. But I guess, you know, Roger Avery figured out that you don't have to be cool in order to get revenge. Revenge is like, it's 2,000 years old, the concept of revenge. You don't need to kill people or be a bully or be cool, whatever. You don't need to get revenge to be cool, and you don't need to be cool while you get revenge. Oh, to clear something up, he did not direct this movie. He just, he wrote the screenplay. And this movie kicks the crap out of Kill Bill any day of the week. Oh yeah, and by the way, Kill Bill, Zed's dead. My name is Paul, and this is between y'all. Okay, Quentin, shut up. It's not that cute. It's not that cool that you use rhyming names. You know, John's gone. It's like Tarantino abandoned all the good qualities about himself as a filmmaker and just focused more on the bad parts, these bad qualities. Oh, I like to use names that rhyme. Oh, I like to show people acting cool. I don't want to write complicated screen or good screenplays anymore. I just want to have people being cool and beating each other up and killing each other. And, you know, it's just really cool. And then in 2007, Roger Avery writes another screenplay for like a 2,000-year-old story called Beowulf. And it was quite good. I wouldn't call it a great movie or anything, but it was, you know, it's awesome for somebody like me who wants to learn a little bit about, like, history and ancient literature. I got to see the story of Beowulf and Grendel. And it was nice to see Avery working on something that wasn't obsessed with being cool, and there was nothing to do with revenge. And he was just writing, which is what writers are supposed to do, right? It shouldn't be about like, hey, look at me, look how cool I am. My name is Quentin Tarantino, and can you believe how cool I am for making this movie? Look at me, I'm so cool. Like, Quentin Tarantino's movies are, and I guess always have been, but are increasingly so self-conscious. Like, he practically wants to come out on the screen and say, I'm doing this. I'm so cool. Aren't I cool? I'm not a geek. Then 2007, Quentin Tarantino experiments again. He's experimenting with his idea of, like, you don't need a story at all. You just need to have revenge. Just revenge and a lot of brutality, and it'll be really cool. And people will like your movie because they think it's cool and you're cool. Because Tarantino isn't satisfied with you thinking that his movie is cool. He also wants you to think that he is very cool. So unlike From Dusk, not From Dusk to Dawn, but Natural Born Killers, he realizes here that, this is what I think, he realizes here that as long as the person doing the killing is a minority, then it's okay for them to kill everybody, and then the audience will sympathize with them. I'm actually surprised this movie didn't do well, since the audiences seem to be so satisfied with Quentin Tarantino just being cool all the time. And I remember reading an interview with Quentin Tarantino where the interviewer asked him, why is it that some filmmakers like Francis Ford Coppola or Tim Burton, why is it that they make all these incredible movies, but then all of a sudden something changes and they just start making crappy movies? And Quentin Tarantino in the interview said, I think what happened was they made one movie that was really special to them and it failed terribly, and it kind of broke them, so then from then on they just played it safe. And I thought that was really interesting, especially in terms of like Tim Burton. And I think maybe Death Proof is that movie for Quentin Tarantino, where it failed so badly it bruised his ego and he said, okay, screw it, I'm not going to even try anymore, and I'm just going to make easy movies, like easy stupid revenge movies with no plot, no effort whatsoever. So doofus Quentin Tarantino decides, hey, I'm going to make a movie where it's a bunch of Jewish people killing Nazis, and therefore I can do whatever the hell I want. I can be as gruesome as possible, and nobody can say anything, and everybody will be rooting for the evil, you know, the murderers, who are Jewish people, because they're Jewish people. And that's basically all I'm going to do. And there's nothing going on in this movie at all, other than that. You know, when this movie got good reviews, I was just like, what planet are they living on? We're obviously living on different planets. This is the worst. It's an awful movie. And, I mean, I don't even really want to get into how bad it is, because it's kind of depressing. But this was a terrible movie. I guess it was one of those cases where it's like the critics were thinking, well, I mean, he's dealing with a very sensitive topic, you know, World War II, Hitler, the Nazis. I don't know what I'm supposed to think, so I guess I'll just say it's really good, because then, you know, people think I'm hip. I guess the critics got fooled into thinking, like, you're not hip if you don't give a good review of this movie. But yeah, so the first one, Kill Bill, was the first of his Revenge of the Nerds trilogy, where it's women getting revenge on men. And then this one is now Jewish people getting revenge on Nazis. But Quentin Tarantino now is armed with the knowledge that as long as he has a minority doing the brutality, audiences will be totally cool with it. And he can act really cool. He can fulfill his desire, his lifelong desire, of showing that he's cool through violence. It was also amazing seeing critics saying there were, like, deeper levels. There was nothing deep in this movie at all. Like, there was that one scene at the end where it's like there's a film within a film. They all go to the film, you know, theater to see a film. And while they're watching the film, the film is happening. No, it's not deep, sorry. It's not even clever. And the first scene in the movie where the villain comes to like a Polish house, and he's like, there's all this suspense because he knows there's people under the floorboards hiding. And I'm like, yeah, I saw that already in the syringe scene in Pulp Fiction, and I saw it already in Four Rooms. You're doing this suspense thing, and it's really not that good. It's not that clever. And it wasn't that suspenseful either. So then, I've already used women to get revenge against men, and I've already used Jewish people getting revenge on Germans. So why not? I don't know, I could use black people to get revenge on white people. Yeah, and then I can use the N-word whenever I want. And it's all very cool because, you know, hey, he's a minority. And I had no interest in seeing this movie. I didn't want to watch it. I was like, I know exactly what it's going to be. But I had the hots for some girl, and she told me to watch it. She said, please watch it. You'll see. It's really good. She was, of course, very young, so I guess she hadn't experienced all that Quentin Tarantino had to offer in his past. So I watched it. It was everything I thought it was going to be. It was, like, I could have predicted the whole movie. The black guy gets revenge on the white guys. And that's the whole story. That's all there is to it. There's no plot. There's no plot twist. I guess you need a plot in order to have a plot twist. No, it's just, I'm going to go here to get revenge. Here I am. I'm going to get revenge now. Okay, I got my revenge. When The Hateful Eight came out, there was no hot chick telling me I should go see it, so I didn't bother watching it. I think I watched like a couple clips. And maybe this wasn't just a revenge movie. Maybe he actually kind of had a story. But at this point, I've just given up on the jerk, you know? I thought he was an incredible filmmaker after Pulp Fiction. All that work was great, and then he just became a lazy slob, and he just wants to be cool, and that's it. Like, what a disappointment. How depressing. I'm going to do another video about Tim Burton, because his career arc went in a similar direction. And I guess the real reason Quentin Tarantino sucks is that he didn't have to suck. He didn't originally suck. He chose to suck. I mean, his next movie might be about a gay guy that gets revenge on straight guys. He's that predictable. And I imagine film history will remember him as a guy who did incredible work up till Pulp Fiction, and then after Pulp Fiction, he just went right down the toilet. And you know how in True Romance, they say she wrote a letter to him, a note that says, "You're so cool." Maybe they should put that on Quentin Tarantino's gravestone. But then I would scratch it out and write, "You're not cool, you're a geek." The curse of being a geek. I was actually going to end this video because I forgot that he made another movie. And it was called Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. And okay, I was wrong when I predicted it would be gays against straights. Okay, this is people getting revenge on the Manson family, pretending that they didn't get away with that crime. What if, you know, there were tough guys like Quentin Tarantino around when the Manson family wanted to strike? So that's all that is. This is just a movie where it's just, the whole point of it is for the Manson family to be brutally murdered. And it's okay because they're the Manson family. And it's cool. It's cool, but it's okay. I didn't even try to watch it, but my mother told me she watched it, and she said it was extremely boring. And she's not a critical person. She would not, like, put anything down. She doesn't like to do that, but she's just like, I don't know, you know, it's just really slow. Well, because I'll tell you why, there's no plot. There's no plot at all. It's just people hanging out, and then they murder the antagonist, which actually isn't really even an antagonist, hardly. But it's okay because the people they're murdering are evil. And they are righteous because, you know, oh, you broke into my house, so now I can just be a complete violent asshole. I didn't even enjoy making this video. I just had to make it for the record because Quentin Tarantino is such a disappointment. If you support gays, click like. If you respect blacks, comment. If you think women are people too, click the notification bell. And if you care about sick children, subscribe.